Check. One. Sibilance. Up here, fellas. Everybody up here. Eyes up here. Good morning, everyone. How the heck are you people? Did you close that door behind you, young man? Thank you. Alaska, right? Use your words. Never been here. My first time. I'm not from up in here. I am from much farther south. I don't want to talk about the south. I want to talk about being up here. Extremely delighted to be here for several reasons. Number one, this is my 50th state to visit. Thank you. Thank you. Hold your applause until the middle. It is my 49th state to speak in. I'm still missing Hawaii. I visited Hawaii. It was right after I graduated from college in the end of the 70s. So many of my memories of the trip are hazy. There will be more jokes like that as the day goes on. What I hope to do when I speak to, let me tell you right now, I'm not a pilot. Very popular with RACA, very popular with, I worked with a lot of the aviation schools and a lot of airlines. I have worked with your Alaska Air. Anybody here from Alaska Air? Anybody? Show of hands, nobody? Oh my God, that's a huge mistake on their part. I was not gonna do any door coming off jokes, but now I hear the senator did, so I think I can too. I speak to a lot of different kind of groups. I'm an old psychotherapist. I speak to nurses. I speak to universities. I have spoken to the thoracic surgery educators, people who operate on the chesticle parts of the body. And what I try to do first is find common ground. A mistake I generally make is spending a long time convincing people that I know about your industry, even though I am not a part of it. I'm not a pilot. Anybody here pilot? Pilot? Got any pilots? People who actually fly planes? Get your hands up if you can raise them. Can I see who's here? Pilots, excellent. Never piloted a plane. I've flown a hang glider. Anybody ever flown a hang glider? Anybody? There you go. They're easy to fly. Hard to launch. You gotta run. Hard to land. Nobody, you landed a hang glider? I'm just going to talk a little bit about flying right now. Hang glider, come down in toward the ground. You with me so far? You see me on a hang glider? I'm prone. Okay? You get close to the ground, I never trust ground effect. You ever heard of ground effect? Is this an English-speaking audience at all? I never trust that when I get close to the ground, I'm going to kind of glide for a minute. You know what I'm talking about? And you know how you stop a hang glider? You push out. If you don't trust ground effect, you know when you push out? Too early. Altitude, no airspeed. I'm just going to quit talking about flying altogether now. I know a lot about the air industry. I've done some research on Alaska as a state. It is, in fact, a state. I don't exactly know why, but we're going to let it go at that. I'm trying to figure out where the common ground is. I thought before I came up here, interesting that y'all are having a conference and you're having me. You should have somebody here from Bravo talking about putting y'all on TV. You need some TV series about y'all. So I did some research. Turns out there was a TV series about y'all. It didn't end well. I decided I would not mention it. And I did. Did a little more research. I found a book by a lady named Colleen Mondor. Anybody ever heard of Colleen Mondor? Do you know who I'm talking about? The title of that book, I'm not even going to say out loud. But it's something about Alaska's pilot culture. And she uses the phrase bush pilot culture. And my question is, how does bush pilot culture relate to attracting young people to the air industry in Alaska? And that is my theme for the day. Is that pretty good? You see where I'm going with this? See, I'm putting all this together. Moving on. I know all this. Don't make me go over all this. You know it too. Let's talk about the generations. Oh, I love this. I've only talked about this 800 times, and I'm more fascinated by it each and every time. We are each a member of one of these generational age groups. You're one. I'm in one. You know when we got signed up? Anybody know when you were enrolled? When you were born. And there you go. Oh, holy snap. And did anybody choose when they were born? Anybody? Nobody chose. We all just got dropped in. In retrospect, I would have chosen when I got born. I'm not going to tell you the year. I bet I do before it's all said and done. I cannot help myself. And then you get born in a certain time, you're raised in a certain time, and you're socialized with all the values of that time. Different times are different. So the values are different. So we turn out different. And I'm going to spend a lot of time talking about what those differences are. I'm going to be doing this on a very high academic level. I got all the degrees a grown person can get. I've worked in universities. I've published academic articles. I am what you call smart as hell. And educated to within an inch of my life. You know what I'm talking about? You know what I'm saying. But I don't know what I can tell you about what you can do with this material. I respect you enough to give you this material and expect you to figure out what to do with it. It would be insulting for me to say this, do this, act like this, but I'm going to empower you to manage these generations. I'm getting worked up now. I'm going. You going to try to break me at lunch? I don't see it happening. No, I'm rolling through lunch, probably into mid-evening. Because I came all this way. And we think we're normal. We think our values are normative. And so we see somebody from another generational group, and we say, what is wrong with them? Why are they not motivated by the same things I'm motivated? Why don't they care about what I care about? We all get here at 8 o'clock in the morning. They don't seem to care about getting here at 8 o'clock in the morning. What is wrong with them? Anybody identify with that? Anybody? Okay, the other generational groups are looking at us and saying, what's the big deal with 8 o'clock? You know, there's another one rolling around tomorrow morning. It doesn't matter. Now, it is very ironic for a psychotherapist like myself, who is very much into the individual, to talk about groups of people at all. But this is all science. It's all data. It's all research. And what I'm talking about are the statistically normative traits, the generational persona, the typical person of the generation. And as I describe that, you're going to decide. Does that sound like me? Does that sound like the people in that generation that I know? And what I'm a little concerned about is, does it sound like Alaska? I've given this in 49 states. They don't argue with me. I've given it in 4 foreign countries. It turns out they don't really argue with me either. So you can disagree with me if you want. You'll be wrong. If you disagree, show me your data. Don't tell me, well, when I grew up, I don't care how you grew up. I'm telling you how the generation grew up. These aren't stereotypes. We're not putting everybody in a box. It's a starting point. And what I like to say, and I'll say it because I like to say it, they're clues, not a box, not putting everybody in the box. I don't need any, I got it. I don't need any help. Now, I'm an old psychotherapist. I'm so old, I trained as a psychoanalyst. In my first graduate program, the big debate was, are you Freudian, Jungian, or Adlerian? That's old school. And one thing we believe is the value of early formative experiences. Not just about your mom, but a lot of it has to do with your mom. How were you raised? What were the values that you heard really early in your life? There's a saying down in my part of the country. Little pitchers have big ears. Anybody ever heard that? Anybody? Somebody say yes. What does it mean? It means babies learn. It means they don't have to have words and concepts to understand what's going on to be impacted. They are just processing all the time. What's a mommy like? What's a daddy like? What's good food? What's bad food? Who are my people? Who are not my people? What are the important things in life? What does it matter? It happens when we're little bitty babies up until, and I can get into the psychology of this if you want me to, really up until about 7 years old when they kind of set. Okay? We got some academics here. We call it the tabula rasa. Writing on the blank slate. And in my line of work, we call that programming our unconscious. Except it's not really unconscious. It comes up all the time. And a lot of times we're unaware of what these are. That's why I give these talks, to tell you what you got programmed with. And they conflict with our conscious ideas. For example, the choice for me, gender free. I am not sexist at all. Went to a mental health conference and I said, anybody work in inpatient psychiatry? Because I used to work in inpatient psychiatry. And a lady said, yes, I do. And I said, are you a nurse? And she said, I'm a physician. I said, son of a bitch. Did not see that coming. Turns out, when I was a little boy, doctors were men. That's my unconscious versus my conscious. That's not a bad example. Really, think about it. My line of work, I think that's pretty good. Nobody chose their programming. We can't blame anybody for their programming. We're not judging, criticizing, or blaming. And I'm going to tell you what the typical programming of your cohort was. If it's working for you, knock yourself out. If you're able to recruit and retain and lead this generation of young people, with your generational programming, congratulations. If not, you might want to think of a different way to deal with the world. I'm going to tell you the same thing I tell all my therapy clients. It's probably not your fault that you're like this, but you're the only one that can change you. Might be mama's fault. Mama dead. You can change you. We'll be heavy. We're about to get down into it. Moving on. Anybody see me? Who saw me speak at Rocket? Anybody? Did you now? You look familiar. Scottsdale. A little different environment than this. Arizona. It's one of the other states, the ones down there. I didn't talk about this at RACA. This is bonus for you. These are kind of the threads that run across all these generations. Over time, we've moved from the community to the individual, from a sense of group where everybody follows the group to where everybody does exactly what they want to do. So we're going to think about that as a theme, from the community to the individual. People are getting younger. Do you know your age? Anybody? That's really not a bad question, because I told a group my age the other day, and then my family pointed out that I have a birthday coming up and what age I would be, and I was wrong. I told the wrong age. I'm about to turn, get ready for this, you're going to hear it, 68. I'm the youngest 68-year-old person that's ever been out there. What were your parents doing at 68, dying? How old are you? You're the youngest person that age that's ever been. We're moving all of the life markers later and later in life. People are growing up and aging more slowly. And the typical baby born today gonna live to 100. And at 100, they'll be acting like people used to at 40. That's funny. That was a good line right there. Nobody liked it. People are getting more diverse. And when I say people, I mean whole groups of people and individual people. The lower 48 is about to no longer be a majority white nation. We're about to become a majority minority nation. We also see more individuals who say they are multiple whatevers. I'm going to regret telling you about this, but I cannot stop myself. That is a personal problem I've been trying to deal with my whole life. Not going to get over it today. There was a great skit on Saturday Night Live where Tom Hanks played America's dad. Anybody ever seen that? America, we know it's a tough time for you. You're growing up, and he gave America the talk like a dad. You're changing. You're growing up. You're growing up. Your skin's getting darker. Yeah, America's getting darker. And you know, you're gayer than you used to be. And you start to do the research on young people and their identification with sexual orientation, a lot of them think that there's not really anything, just everybody's everything. We can disagree. Moving on. Go watch that video. It is. Technology is becoming more integral and more complex. Any technology in your line of work? Use your words, please, people. Talk back to me. Talk back to me. Okay. Last week, I spoke to a bunch of line workers, rural line, and they were line men. That is one of the few occupations that still uses men in their title. They were line men. Those people don't speak, and they're not used to sitting down. They're used to being outside up hanging from a pole or something. Y'all are used to sitting down, but apparently you don't talk to anybody. Moving on. Technology is becoming more integral and complex, and we're about to get to the place that what can humans do better than a machine? Answer, almost nothing. And I could spend the whole time talking about trends in employment as technology takes over. What did I tell you about taking pictures? Straight on. Like Ronald Reagan, you can only shoot me head on. No side shots. Head on, the only possible shot. Straight ahead. I'm monitoring you every second. Y'all have not been photographed as much as I have, so you're just not used to the paparazzi like I am. And with a lot of young people, we blur the lines. Okay, I'm about to get into the program proper here. I'm right on the verge of it. All right, here it is. My favorite graph. We have an economist back here. He will explain the graph. You graph in the economics business? Y'all graph in aviation? Graphing? I watched Masters of the Air last night, episode 1. Anybody heard about that, Masters of the Air? Okay. I think next year you should call this conference Masters of the Air Alaska. That's good. That's good. What's wrong with that? Moving on. I started that for a good reason. Lost it there. It may come back to me. Oh, favorite graph. They were very much into checklists. And I thought that was really hilarious that in this action series, they're getting ready to take off this big old flying fortress. And they say, okay, do you have the checklist? I'm like, well, let's just go bureaucratic right now before the battle. Engines on? Yes. I didn't see any graphs. That's where I was going with this. I didn't see any graphs. Here's a graph. The line across the bottom, which the people in economics call the x-axis, is year. I'm in your way, I know that. Sorry. The number up the side, number of babies born in America in that year. Year babies. Well, step aside and let every single person in this room do what you need to do is find your year and say, there I am. Some of y'all are going, holy cow, I'm a 57. Big group. I'm a 75. What happened? Where are all the people? Very interesting flow, the demographic flow. And if we wanted to, which I do, we can break it into 5 generational cohorts with these lines right here. See the black lines? Those break up the generational groups. They're really kind of fuzzy lines. They're kind of moving around. This line in 1945 at the end of World War II is the most stable of all of them. The rest of them are just almost randomly put in there. But that line in 1945, when everybody came home from World War II with a lot of enthusiasm. And I mean, they got after. Rest of the line's a little vaguer. five groups. I'm going to drill right down into them, and I hope before lunch to cover the first three. So at lunch, you can talk about, well, he said my group is like this, but I'm more like this other group. Because really, it's partly about the groups, but it's more about the models. And there are a lot of people who are going to say, well, I'm younger, but I'm more like this model. Deep. We're just deep stuff here. Traditionals, the people that came up before 1945, 78 and older. Bless their hearts, they're getting long in the tooth. Most of them left the workplace. Where I really want to spend most of my time is with the cohort that everyone agrees is the pinnacle of generational achievement in America or any other nation, the baby boom generation. That generation against which all other generations are judged and found lacking. But young people, have no doubt, it is a boomer world and you are just living in it. The youngest of us are 58, but we are generally large, in charge, and not going anywhere soon. You don't love us now, you better learn how to. And then, the most startling part of the whole graph, the falling birth rate. Pinnacle, just nadired, use nadir in economics? The nadir, in about 73, 4, 5, almost no babies. That makes no sense. Well, may get on some thin ice here. That's a good Alaska metaphor. Thin ice. Thin ice. Y'all know where babies come from? And if you don't say yes, I'm going to explain. I'll get a flip chart. I'll draw a picture, damn it. Do you know?
Yes.
Thank you. They're like, oh Lord, I don't want to hear his explanation of that. When a mommy and daddy. Okay, anyway. Do you know how a society gets a lot of babies? There you go. You got to have a lot of people enjoying each other's company in that special way, right? Think about 1973. Y'all weren't there. I was. The rules about enjoying one another's company were the loosest they had ever been. And a lot of the people who were around back then don't admit it, but it was a phenomenal time to be alive. I'm not bragging, I'm just speaking demographically. But somehow or other, all of that activity and no babies. Well, the pill had some impact, but I'm going to say it was social ideas that had a greater impact. Yeah, that's where I'm going. So there was this dark time of no babies. We call it Gen X. You know why we call y'all Gen X? Anybody? We couldn't even be troubled to come up with a clever name. We thought we'll put an X in, we'll come back later and fix it up. We never came back. We were busy. We were doing other stuff. Kind of like your birthday. We meant it to be better. We meant it to be better. These folks tend to be 58 to 38 now. So this tend, the boomers tend to be kind of an owner class. And the Xers tend to be kind of a management class now. Mm-hmm. And then babies got popular again, and here comes a group that some people call millennials. Have you ever heard of the millennials? Ever heard of them? Would you know one when you saw one? How would you know one if you saw one? Do you have a drum sound effect over there? A chopping. 5 o'clock. You go, man. You go, man. Well, when they first started talking about millennials, they were so wrong that I started calling them Generation Next. And I started writing a bunch of articles that kind of made me famous in the academic world about this generation because I call them Generation Next. And I'm going to call them Next. Today, millennials is the other term. You call them whatever you want to, but if you call them millennials to my face, it's going to be on like a Donkey Kong. And there's another group that is just now coming up. We're not really sure what we're going to call them. It looks like we're going with Generation Z. We could have been more creative. We put in about as much effort as we did on Gen X. But that's up to about 24 years old. And this line is really vague. Don't really get too married to it. Okay, how are we doing on time? Officially, terrible. Gonna move lunch to 3:30. Let's tell the restaurant, 3:30. All right, here we go. And I put 65 up there because that's retirement age. And so we know a lot of the boomers have already retired. And blah, blah, big issue in the workplace, replacing retiring people. The story for the last 20 years plus has been all of these people are retiring. There are not enough of these people to take their place, and these people may not be ready to move into those roles. That's the big story. And I'm going to talk about more about that as we move on. I got to get on with this. So we're going to talk some about the traditions. We know they are mostly gone from the workplace. But their model is phenomenally important because they are the last of the old school. If we look at parenting practices and we look at values models, in many ways, they are more like the Puritans who came over from England because they couldn't get laws in England passed that were strict enough to please them. Then they're like those of us who came later. So we talk about them just because they're such old school. And I'm really curious as to how this resonates here in the great state of Alaska. And when I talk cross-culturally, there's more similarities in this group than any other group. We're talking people who are over 78 years old. Do you know anyone over 78 years old, yes or no?
Yes.
Get that person in your mind. Can you see them? Excellent. See if this sounds like them. They were very impacted by the Depression and World War II, but they never talked about it. They were little kids in the Depression during those formative values times. So they tend to value sacrifice. The community is everything, and individual needs mean nothing. As kids, they had low nurturing. Not a lot of loving offered these babies. Not a lot of cuddling to those little people. They valued duty, discipline, and thrift. Do your job, follow the rules, and save your money. Does that sound like the older people you know, yes or no? And they have left, and they took duty with them. Last generation to do anything just because it's what you're supposed to do. They value loyalty, formality, and respect. You got to treat each other properly. You're already about to get heavy. When they came up, the church was the center of the community. They built a culture based on faith, stability, and conformity. You keep a culture going by keeping it stable. The way you keep it stable is for everybody to follow all the rules and conform to social expectations. Y'all might not have thought about that part of the older people, but conformity and stability are code for stay in your place. If these people knew your gender, your age, your complexion, and your socioeconomic status, they could tell you what you could and could not be doing. And a lot of people tended to agree. They not here to have a good time because their reward is not of this earth anyway. Does that sound like the older people you know so far, yes or no? Sound like us? Not really. Not here to have a good time. I will really stress the power of social roles. And it's kind of painful to talk about, but a lot of these people didn't really have any choice in how their lives went because the social roles so dictated what they did. If you were a girl and you grew up in this particular community, you were probably going to get married off to one of these boys, and you were probably going to stay home with some kids, whether that's what you wanted to do or not. Because the social roles were so powerful. And they believed, be predictable. There are some folks who say, these were the good old days. Pros and cons. Pros and cons. I don't want that to be the debate topic at lunch. I'll give you some more fun things to talk about. Now, I'm going to get into an area that I only know about academically. Let's talk about indigenous peoples in Alaska. The reason I talk about them right now is because I've been kind of around the world and I've been a lot of places, have a lot of indigenous cultures, and we generally call those traditional cultures. What an interesting choice of words. And I talk about them now because in many ways those cultures maintain traditional patterns, practices, and rituals, unlike a lot of the rest of the culture. And so a lot of the conflict between those cultures and mainstream cultures is that mainstream cultures have moved on from those traditional practices. And it is their way. They have tended to stay more community-oriented than moving toward the individual. I'll just tell you real fast. Communities offer security. Being an individual offers freedom. Which do you want? You want both. And the human dilemma is if we get too tucked into a community, we say, where are my freedom? And we get over here into freedom and we say, where are my connections? Where are my connections? And these groups tend to have maintained more community orientations, more multi-generational households. Is that true in Alaska? Now, what happened? Y'all didn't see this coming, but those multi-generational households where they still value elders and what elders have to teach, and don't get me started. But in 2024, don't nobody care what an old college professor has to say. They more interested in the Kardashians. I think people should value elders more. Hear what I'm saying? Which means somebody can get my plate at lunch. Now, downside of multi-generational households, man, that made them COVID vulnerable. Once it got up into those communities and they're all piled up in together, really decimated those communities. And you know what allows those communities to survive? You people. I'm about to get teared up, because if it wasn't for you, those cultures could not survive. I don't think. Maybe I'm misunderstanding something completely. So I don't really have a dog in this hunt, but thank you for what you do. And I hope you recognize that cultural community valuable service. Do you appreciate that? Use your words. Pat yourselves on the back and go, go us, go we. Moving on. Let the good times roll. Here come the baby boomers. We have been called the demographic pig in a python. That's a lovely image, isn't it? If you don't know what a python is, that's okay. It's a tropical snake, not indigenous to this area. Y'all have snakes up here? Oh, that's... pets. I don't need to hear about that. Weirdo. Pig and a python. Think about a python swallowing a pig. It strains every part of the python as it moved through. More information than you need. When I was born, they had just built a new hospital to birth all of us babies. And they just tore it down. Very symbolic. And so we've moved through education and the workplace. And now we are straining some of the least attractive parts of the python, but we're still moving through in a big bunch. The first thing to know about us is we are not traditionals. Young people, that is not the Scooby-Doo mystery machine. And it turns out Scooby-Doo is about 40 years old now anyway. That is a mid-70s Volkswagen micro minivan, which I remember from when I started college, decorated like that. I remember them floating up off the ground. Good time. But this one is decorated with the leaves of the variegated Scheffalera plant. And I don't remember that the Scheffalera was that significant back in the day. Many of my memories are somewhat hazy. Weed. And unlike Arkansas, y'all just have stores up here. Just walk in, get your weed. Man, in Arkansas, we still got to have a guy. It has not changed. Turns out we are here to have a good time. We are not like those traditionals. And the biggest generational break of all times was us from those traditionals. And this is a wonderful, specific day to be doing this, because the culture changed on February 9 of 1964. The 60th anniversary of this event is tomorrow. The biggest day in the culture in my lifetime. What happened? Go, man. Biggest day in my lifetime. The Beatles on Ed Sullivan. There has nothing been that culturally big happen since. And you may say, have you heard of Taylor Swift? Nothing like this. Michael Jackson, nothing like this. Totally changed the culture. And as of February 9, nobody wanted to be in the rat pack anymore. Everybody wanted to be young. And so we have been young ever since. And we broke with all of those traditional values. This is a movie called The Wild Ones, starring Marlon Brando as the leader of a motorcycle gang called, what's the gang called? The Rebels. And a girl asked him, what are you rebelling against? And what he said? What do you got? Duty, discipline, thrift, sacrifice, sobriety, the delay of gratification. We will go the other way. And so growing up boomer was a very unique experience. 75 out of 100 of us grew up in a beaver cleaver household. Mom at home with kids while dad went to work. We had a mom at home, but she would not let us into the house. We got any boomers here? Can I get an amen on would not let us into the house? If you went into the house, what would your mom say? Go outside and play. What a mission statement. We were the only ones who grew up with that mission statement. Traditionals had to work. They were in coal mines. People that came later didn't have that level of freedom. We were free-range children. We were feral children. Marginally supervised. Just out in the world. Just learning how to get along. We didn't have a bunch of toys. We didn't have stuff. We had to make up games. I can name about 5 or 6 games that you can play with no equipment at all. Hide and seek, tag, freeze tag. There's a lot of variations on the tag theme. We'd say, Mom, we don't have anything to do. She'd say, well, here's a can. Knock yourselves out. What do you play with a can? Kick the can. We learned how to create, we learned how to get along, we learned how to compete and cooperate, we learned what we were good at and what other people were better at. Now, there was adult supervision in the community. They were kind of monitoring us from afar, and that traditional generation, they would hit us. You remember that? Anybody's mom could spank you. You young people are saying, well, I don't, you know. There are some states in the lower 48 where if an adult spanks a child in the privacy of their home, they'll probably get a visit from social services the next day. But you young people, you might say, I was spanked. Not like back in the day. You youngsters never walked into the Piggly Wiggly and seen a mom with a fly swatter that she has not even bought. Just going, just working out on some child. And boomers, if your mom saw that, would she have been horrified? Would she have said, oh my God, child abuse, better call protective services? No, she'd have said, go Mildred. Bend your knees, you're getting up on his back. Get down, wrist, Mildred, wrist. And we had some technology. We had dial telephones on the wall. Everybody hear what you're saying. I don't know how we planned parties. We would have bonfires down by the river, but we couldn't cell phone people. How did we network that? I mean, there was some cruising going on. Maybe before school let out, we'd say, bonfire at the river, bonfire at the river. You can't come. Bonfire at the river, bonfire at the river. I don't know how it worked out. But we didn't watch TV every night like it was our job. Moving on. Here's the big change, the big social change. We moved from the church to the school. We moved from faith, belief, and trying to maintain stability to research and reason toward progress. You don't find your answers in an old book, you find it through modern research and scientists. We're going to send, I've used this line before and I'm hating it right now. We thought we're going to send a man to the moon. We thought we're going to cure all the diseases with vaccines. And just from the scientific community, we were doing great with vaccines until this last one. And on behalf of the scientific community, I want to say, we're sorry about this last vaccine. We got your hopes up with mumps and measles and rubella. See, we told you, you take that polio vaccine, you're not going to get the vaccine, you're not going to get polio. We give you this vaccine, damn, you still get it. You take seven of these vaccines, you still get it. We're having to kind of change the odds, and just on behalf of university people everywhere, we're sorry about that. We could have done better. We probably over-advertised. Moving on. And that was not political at all. But if you want to scrap, come on with it. If you want to scrap, bring it on. And there's been a conflict between faith and science ever since. There's that conflict really came up. Now, I don't know where you see boomers, wherever you see them, you're fortunate to see them. We are fabulous to be around. Working with us, we are very social. Remember, we were out in groups of people all along, so we really like people. We want to be around you. We want to talk to you. We want to get to know you. We want to make friends with you. We want to intrusively know about areas of your lives that are really none of our business, because that's how we make friends. We tend to be friendly. And so if you're working with us, you better make friends first. If I'm your boss, The more you are willing to become friends with me, the more successful you will be in my organization. If all you're doing is talking to me, young people, write that shit down, because that is a takeaway right there. Sorry, Will. I'm still working on Central Time and some of my filters I think I left back on the West Coast. Moving on. If you're in my organization, make friends with me. If all we're doing is interacting for 5 minutes, you better start with, how you doing? Hey, how you doing? If you know anything about me, throw that in there. Hey, Dr. Taylor, how you doing? How's your daughter? You start like that, it's gonna go great. And try to get along. We don't like fussing. We don't like conflict. Don't come to me and complain about you not being able to get along with somebody else. That's your own problem. And how you doing, that's what I call interpersonal warm-up. And we're big picture people. We're on a mission. We want to make a difference in the world. We thought if we wore black armbands, we'd stop a war. We thought if we sang Kumbaya and We Shall Overcome, we would solve all the social problems in the world. We think we're magical, and we think we can make a difference. If in our work we are trying to make a difference, we aren't just trying to get tasks done. So if you want to relate to me, talk about the mission. Don't just talk about getting this plane from point A to point B. Talk about how this plane getting to point B is going to help somebody. That's solid material right there too. I'm impressed with myself today. I'm coming up with some really good stuff. So talk about those impacts. Six after, what do you want me to do? I'd like to do another 15 before we break for lunch, but what? I'm talking to Will right now. Go or stop? Keep going? Can y'all take Gen X? Or I tell you what would be totally appropriate would be for me to just not talk about Gen X at all. And then come back after lunch and pick up with the younger people. That seems to make perfect sense to me. And the Xers are like, I am so not surprised. So not surprised. Okay, Boomer. Talk about these Xers for just a minute. This is that time that the birth rate plummeted. On that big graph, those boomer Xer generations are like a wave coming through. A very unique transitional time. 75 out of 100 of us boomers' moms were at home. 75 out of 100 of Xers had a mom. Well, okay, what's the point of my dad being up in this corner right here? Is that really, thank you so much, kind of freaking me out. How'd y'all channel my dad up there? You may say, I've had that experience. Looked in the mirror, I'm like, Mom? Hey, welcome, Mom. Because when she leaves, Grandma showing up. 75 out of 100 of Xers had a mom at work. That exodus of mom from home to the workplace was the biggest social change since dad left the farm to go to work in the Industrial Revolution. And states like Arkansas, that took a pass on the Industrial Revolution in general, that's the biggest social change since the Civil War. And you Xers were there when it changed. Now, a lot had to change for mom to be able to go to work. The social message became women self-actualize at work, not at home. When I was growing up, a woman self-actualizing as a wife and mother was certainly enough. Then it became, oh, no, no, are you only a housewife? You've got to get out in the world. And if you're trying to make it in the workplace, kids are not going to help you. I'm just saying. Kids became seen as an obstacle to growth, and cultural narratives about kids had to support that change. So they started making movies like Rosemary's Baby, Child as Demon. And if you're a young happening baby boomer, why would you invite that into your home? And the Xers are going, Dr. Taylor, that's just one movie. Exorcist, Omen, Damien, Firestarter, Children of the Corn, Stop Me Anytime. It was a theme. Now, that going to work was good for women. It increased their choices. It increased their opportunity. It increased their economic strength. I don't want to go into a lot of grisly, but it made them able to lead their own lives instead of just being a part of this other machine. But it made parenting more challenging, and it was a super tough time to be a kid and a super tough time for a lot of kids. We see the generation of the latchkey kid. Have you heard of that? Okay, remember, my people were feral children. These people had to come home and let themselves into the house. What did her mama tell her to get her to stay in the house? What was the phrase? Stranger danger. Don't go outside. Somebody get you. There are white vans cruising through the neighborhood 24 hours a day. If you stick your head onto that front porch, it'll suck you right in. We'll never see you again. Boomers, did we think the world was a dangerous place? No! Turns out there were creeps and weirdos out there back in the day. We didn't know. There was also a lot of divorce, more single parenting, more blended families, just a lot more disruption. So, Xers tend to be more skeptical and cautious, less trusting and open than we baby boomers are, because they have been taught you have to protect yourself. Protect yourself. So I start asking all these intrusive questions, and they say, why would I tell you that? Why do you need to know that? More independent and more self-sufficient. If I was building a go-kart, your hands were right there to help me get that wheel on. If her Nintendo breaks, nobody there to help her except herself. She's got to work it out. And how do you fix a Nintendo? Blow on it. You know that. Do they not know that? So, X, this is a huge difference. You know what I'm talking about. So a huge difference is boomers are relational and Xers are more transactional. Xers will interact, but it's around the deal. It's around whatever the immediate outcome is. Boomers will interact because that's what we do. That is air for us. Traditionals were loyal to whatever there was to be loyal to. We boomers are loyal to the people. Xers tend to be more loyal to themselves and are looking for portable skills. Xers had a very short childhood, had to be responsible team members early, had to take care of themselves. Mama has her job, daddy has his job, and you have your job. Your job's to go to school and not get in trouble, because mama cannot be leaving her job to come down here and get you. And the Xers are going, I'm flashing back a little bit right now. Kind of scaring me, Dr. Taylor. Get a little more academic, please. Let's take it from this level to this level. More pragmatic and task-oriented than mission-oriented. And boomers are trying to make friends. So the way we talk is the way you talk to friends. Xers not that interested in making friends. So they tend to be more direct in their communication, possibly blunt. In every group of Xers, there is a blunt one. And if you don't know who it is, it's you. And just for the record, Xers, y'all don't talk to each other like that. Don't talk to me like that. Don't talk to the young people like that either. And we're about to make another huge social change. Anybody want to guess where we're going? From the church to the school to the mall. From religion to science to sales. What's the deal? Who is trying to sell me what? What is the cost-benefit ratio? Boomers do some things even if the cost-benefit ratio is low because it will help somebody. Traditionals do stuff just because it's the right thing to do. Xers, it's what's the cost benefit. That was a big, that consumerism, big reason mom went to work. Because we need more stuff. We need bigger stuff and newer stuff. People say, well, everybody has to work now. You can't live on one person's salary like you used to. Well, my family lived on one person's salary and it was not that great. We didn't have $1,000 a month in technology bills. We had one car. We had 1,200 square feet for five people. You gonna live like that? I think not. Everybody's gonna go to work. Matter of fact, I'm about to advocate child labor again. Y'all got any kids? Who's got kids? Who could use a few more dollars coming in? There's a formula there that's pretty apparent to me. Xers created work-life balance. Boomers, I'm sorry I'm saying this in front of the group, but boomers tend to live to work. We identify with the work. We get satisfaction from the work. We like being around the other people. We live to work. Xers work to live. Life is what happens away from work. Well, yes, I'm a pilot with this regional carrier, but really, I'm a dancer. And I just fly enough to keep the dancing going. And if the dancing took off, I'd quit flying altogether. Y'all identify with that, don't you? got some dancers, I guess you do. So just nuts and bolts, resent work-life spill, and might not be interested in leadership. Gen X is the first generation to say, I don't want to go into management. I'm good right here. I'd go into management, but I see how you boomer managers live, and I'm not going there. And so what boomer managers have to think about is making management more manageable. Oh, I'm going to wrap this up. So tell them we're about to come out. Tell them about it in about 2 minutes. We're going to hit them like a bunch of locusts. Xers tend to be those independent, adaptable, pragmatic scrappers. So if you're working with them, just be direct. Say what you need to say. Sometimes we baby boomers are careful because we don't want to hurt anybody's feelings. Xers just want to hear the truth, and you can't hurt their feelings anyway, and they're not that concerned if you like them or not. More convenient than we thought. And this is all you need to know about management. Two levels of management. One is, I need you to do this now. Pick that up and put it down. Directing tasks. The next level is, here's the mission. We need this to happen. Make it happen. And our big goal with employees is to move them from direction to mission. That's a mouthful right there. That's a big package right there. Xers are invested in developing durable, portable, competitive career skills. Xers know that life is like a shark. If you're not moving forward, you're dying. And if they're at your company, and they're moving forward, they will stay. If they're not, they will leave. It increases their retention, and just reconsider what your leadership expectations are. We're about to move into some young people. If you think you're up to it, we'll wisely recognize that this material is so intense that you kind of need a few minutes just to decompress. Let it kind of settle down a little bit. Nurture, nourish yourself. So what's the plan here? You're going to eat as quickly as you possibly can, and we're going to start back. Is that about right? Food out there? You always say something at the end. Go eat. Save your applause.
I can remember when we walked together, sharing a love I thought would last forever. Moonlight to show the way so we can follow. Waiting inside her eyes was tomorrow. Then something changed her mind. Her kisses told me I had no love in arms to hold me. Every day I wake up, then I start to break up, lonely as a man without love. Every I'm cannot face this world that's fallen down on me. So if you see my girl, please send her home to me. Tell her about my heart that's slowly dying. Say I can't stop myself from.
turn cold.